all of this is made possible by this little thing we call the silicon chip, which is starting to think. And what I mean by that is that today, this smartphone many of you have in your pocket has the ability to do what most of us can do in 1 or 2 seconds. So 1 or 2 seconds of thinking, whatever work requires 1 or 2 seconds of thinking can be now done by machines. And that's going to expand to the 5 seconds. It's already in the research labs, and maybe about a minute in the next 5 to 10 years. And when that happens, if you look closely, most of the work we do as a society, as an industrial society, does not require more than, you know, 5 to 15 seconds of thinking. So, and this curve behind you, curve in front of you, shows where silicon is heading. 2025 is approximately the inflection point where the smartphone you have in your pocket will have as much processing power as the human brain. Today it is somewhere between an insect and a mouse. It's already doing a lot of interesting things. And when that happens, several things starts happening. And I'm going to give examples of India. This is not a US-centric or a Japan-centric issue. Manufacturing is getting automated. If you look at a lot of auto parts manufacturers in Chennai, they're using more automation than labor already. I have a friend who runs one of the largest yarn mills, turning cotton into yarn in Delhi. And he has one worker for every 20,000 spindles. His father started with one for every 20. And the story goes on and on. And it's not just manufacturing. Services are getting automated. You know, checkout clerks will disappear. Accounting will cease being a profession. It will become an expertise if you are a financial expert, and so on. And the story goes on and on. And household work will also similarly be going away. All of you have heard about automated cars. It's quite in the news, right? India has 6 million drivers. Now, people think that automation of cars will only happen in the US. But if you look closely at the cost involved, Tesla is spending approximately $15,000 retrofitting its cars for automation. $15,000 is about 8 lakh rupees. And 8 or 9 lakh rupees, and the EMI on that is approximately 15,000 rupees per month, which is the salary of a driver. So we are getting to the inflection point where not just the US, everywhere in the world, automation will consume us. And of course, similarly in the service industry, if you ever bought anything from Flipkart on Amazon, the product you bought was probably touched by a robot which picked it up and put it into the box that came to your house. And many people think that only products and services which are mechanical in nature are getting automated. Most of Reuters sports news and most of financial news from Thomson is actually auto-generated. The news reports are auto-generated, they're not written by hand, including the one in front of you. Lot of the art you see in magazines and media is machine-generated. This is computer-generated art. And you have heard computer-generated music in elevators, you don't know it. But the question is, you know, why does it matter for India? It seems like a developed country paradigm. Why do we need to import it? Why does India need automation? Should we not just ban it because it's going to get rid of jobs? And it will. The reason is that India is India is a country of 1.3 billion people, where a billion people are left out of the gates, right? They don't have healthcare, they don't have education, and so on. And in that context, how do we bring education, healthcare of world-class quality, which we all aspire to, and nutrition and so on, to all the billion people who are currently left out? 750 million people only have one meal a day. How do we solve that problem? This problem is going to be solved using the same technology that is going to disrupt everything else. And some of the examples behind me in healthcare are already starting to do that. There's this Tricorder Prize, X Prize, which is going to, I think, be finalized next year, which is going to have the single device which will diagnose the top 80 diseases, which is, by the way, better than what most doctors can do today. And finally, just a few stats. The World Bank and the Brookings Institute completed a study recently which said that 69% of Indian jobs are at risk in the next 8 years. McKinsey released a report saying that 250 million IT jobs, and these include IT jobs in India, are going to be wiped out by 2025. And interestingly, Infosys just announced 3 days ago that they have reduced 8,000 jobs in the last year because of automation. And if you look at closely at their quarterly statement, they only hired 5,000 last year instead of 15,000 because of the same reason. So, Rob, I will ask you this question. Seems like a very frightening experience where we are a country with already less than 150 million people working, and we are talking about 69% of those jobs disappearing, right? Do you believe it? Do you actually agree that this is going to happen? And how do you, I mean, you travel across Africa and India. How do you see development playing out in this scenario?
Okay, so no problem. Thank you for letting me go first, Lalitesh. I appreciate it. And I'm really looking forward to hearing what everyone else has to say about this challenging situation as well. Yeah, I think probably it's true. I think that probably 69% of the jobs we have today will disappear. Probably all of them will disappear in due course because the labor market continues to transition, and it is always transitioning as technology pushes things along. As you were talking, I was thinking of John Maynard Keynes, the Nobel Prize winning economist and intellectual of the early 20th century, who predicted somewhat the same thing, that with the continuing evolution of technology and innovation, eventually there would be no need for people to work. We'd live, as he called it, as lilies field. In fact, he predicted that by the end of the 20th century, you would be more or less living like lilies field. And here we are, 2016 or 17 now, and I don't feel like a lily in the field. You know, we're going into a strange time politically in America with people complaining about the rate of transition of our labor market, but that transition goes on. It goes on very aggressively. That tension, which is reflected in other parts of the world as well, including in India, is in part driven by innovation. Global innovation, global competition, people constantly striving to get in front of one another and be better. And I don't mean that in a negative sense. I mean that in the most positive sense of the aspiration of the human spirit and the outlet of our intellects in creative ideas and improvements to one another's lives. But it is disruptive, and I think something that we have to guard against very much as we go through the next, probably, as you suggest, IT-driven transformation of our culture and workforce. We will have to very carefully guard against the disruption in people's lives, especially, I would say, toward the bottom of the pyramid. And certainly it would be absurd to suggest that the people at the bottom of the pyramid in India are in the same situation as people at the bottom of the pyramid in the United States, but the people lower down on the strata tend to experience these stresses the most. What I found very inspiring from the discussion last night at our wonderful emphasis event was the vision that Desh presented of this being a project of communities of entrepreneurs and people who help advise entrepreneurs and enable innovation to expand and scale in society. And I think the further point that was made in the final panel of the evening of the vision of 1,000 Deshpande centers springing up across India to enable communities everywhere to work together toward this positive vision of using innovation to create new opportunities. So that's my response to your provocative introductory statement. I can talk more later about what we're trying to do at MIT to move things along, but maybe I'll give the others a chance to
get to that. And I'll hand over the mic to Jayesh. So Jayesh, you have built an extraordinary reputation in a very short period of time of being a disruptor, somebody who adopts technology faster than techies do and implements it at the scale that the government can. This is a culture that I think all of India needs. So what is your secret? How do you make it happen? And how can both NGOs and technologies help the government further to help people like you pull off the impossible?
Well, thank you, Lalitesh. Let me cover a little bit of your first question, the introductory point, and that gives a good segue to what you have asked for. See, while it may be true that 69% of the jobs may disappear in the next 8 to 10 years, but our sense is that they will be replaced by different kinds of jobs. So for instance, if you feel that machine learning is going to drive lots of manufacturing, lots of others lines of activity, but eventually someone has to write those codes, someone has to write those algorithms, someone has to do multiple iterations for the machine to learn all those things. Similarly, other important areas like cybersecurity, data analysis, data warehousing, and so many new opportunities will emerge. So one of the important responsibilities which we are taking on our shoulders in the state of Telangana is to prepare our students right now for these next waves of opportunity. So we have a very unique institution called the Telangana Academy for Skills and Knowledge, in which we try to do that precisely. In fact, and we do it at a very large scale. Last year we touched close to 40,000 students. The idea is to find out from the companies like Infosys and others, what are the technologies they are actually deploying. See, all of us will know that unlike the MITs of the world, the university system, the college system in India is not so agile. What is being taught in the colleges is not what is getting deployed today in the offices. And it will take easily a lag of 4 to 5 to 8 years, even in the best technology schools, for the latest stuff to be taught. So we try to fill this gap by making the students ready about what is actually getting deployed by giving them additional modules. We design these modules with the help of the industry and so on and so forth. Now, the other important point is that if the future is going to be so consumed, so driven by technology, what can the government do? Either you kind of let technology steamroll over you, or you be better prepared, you try to embrace technology. So obviously in our state of Telangana, we choose the latter course. Now, first of all, many of you would be aware, Desh alluded to it in his morning session, that we have a very, very amazing incubator, which is called the T-Hub. It is, for the time being, the largest in the country, and congratulations to Naveen and his team for having the audacity to think of, but as an aside, let me tell you that you can exceed it by, let us say, in six months by a few thousand SFT. But what about the second phase that we are building? That will be 400,000 SFT. So will you have the thought to even surpass that? But that's quite interesting. The more such incubators come up in the country, the better it is, because the youth today in India are also consumed by that passion to create something, to be also counted amongst the big league. So in Telangana, we have done a lot to ensure that all the government agencies, first of all, become big consumers of technology. We have a very interesting procurement policy, which says that if any startup has a product or a solution which is relevant for the government system, we'll consume it bilaterally, we'll procure it bilaterally without making them go through the complicated, cumbersome procurement processes. And we are always open to good solutions which can come up from anywhere, because the leadership in Telangana strongly believes that no one is the repository of all wisdom. You have to look around, you have to collaborate, and right from a small 3-member team, 4-member team startup to some of the big names of the technology work, our doors are open to everyone. We are today, for instance, working on some blockchain solutions which IBM has created for us, and some solutions on smart city which a 3-member team and T-Hub is doing. So everyone has a space, and the more you are open to these kind of opportunities, the better prepared you will be. But one last point, I 100% agree with Bob, is the real challenge will be in the bottom of the pyramid. See, when we say that we are training our students to be future ready, obviously they are not representing the bottom of the pyramid. Some may be, but a majority of them are not. And how do we ensure that their needs are also catered to by emerging technologies and they are not left behind, is a problem which we are still grappling with. And we do hope that institutions like the Sandbox, as Desh mentioned in the morning, Nizamabad is also a location for the Kakatiya Sandbox. And again, in a matter of a few months, We are putting together a rural incubator with the help of Deshpande Foundation. And we hope that technology enabled solutions for the bottom of the pyramid will come from institutions like that. But as of now, it still remains a very daunting and a very, very kind of a large and important pressing challenge.
Do you see the very same technology, including the India stack and various digital systems, enabling you to deliver services to the bottom of the pyramid far more efficiently than you were able to?
So definitely the basic infrastructure needs to be put in place. For instance, if India stack has to work, our rural households, the villages require connectivity, which we lack majorly. So in Telangana, we have a very ambitious program. As many of you would be aware, in India today, we don't even supply drinking water to every house. In the villages, if you need water, you have to go to a common place and you need to fetch it from there. And again, it has lots of social implications. Typically, it is the women who are supposed to go and do that work. And in a hierarchy-driven kind of rural society, there are again hierarchical issues and so on and so forth. So in our state, we are attempting a very ambitious project of providing drinking water, tap drinking water to every household. And to do so, we are laying close to 150,000 kilometers of drinking water pipelines. And we are doing this massive trenching. So we have seen this as an opportunity to lay cable also, fiber cable also, OFC also, in the same water pipelines. And had we done it as a standalone program, almost 60 to 70% of that money would have just gone for trenching and filling up those trenches. So we have saved on those 60-70% costs. And once we are able to provide this connectivity, if definitely India Stack is a wonderful innovation. The entire demonetization pitch which rolled out which is still rolling out for the last 3-4 months, we have been able to soften the impact to a large extent because of the innovations of India Stack. But we need to do more. In the earlier session, it was pointed out that we still have huge challenges in health, in education, and so on and so forth. Digital has the solution, but that connectivity is needed at the grassroots level. And with that, opportunities for people locally to find local solutions, the precise philosophy of Sandbox. And hopefully the one which will come up in Nizamabad, the rural incubator, and the connectivity drive which we are pushing from the top will together create a very good platform for some of these rural bottom of the pyramid issues to be resolved.
Thanks, Jayesh. That was almost breathtaking to hear. You are doing everything from connecting everybody and the top, you are riding, you're surfing the technology wave and then transforming the workforce into from traditional workers to being innovators and being thinkers. Ravi, so Jayesh is setting up, I'm saying the last, best for the last. Ravi, if you imagine all of India doing what Jayesh is doing, which not yet, but imagine they do. You create this environment for startups. You have bright people and there is this environment where people have been trained to do startups. There are incubators everywhere and so on. If you imagine a developed India, it would need a GDP of about $40 trillion. And about 20 of that needs to come from these startups and these technology powerhouses because arbitrage as an income source will start disappearing. How are you pulling that off? Because you are responsible for turning the whole world into a bunch of bright startups. How are you pulling it off? What are the challenges you face, and what are the things you get excited about?
Thanks, Lalitesh. It's interesting that India, until about 15th century, had the largest GDP in the world. And then in the 16th century, it ceded that position to China and then came back again in the 17th century. And then thereafter, it's been, going downhill since that time. Primarily because of the industrial revolution where the entire per capita economics started going in a very different way. And now we have another opportunity where information technology gives us a chance to do something very differently from what we, went through for the last 200-300 years. And, if you look at where the current GDP of India comes from, it's not a lot of that comes from the large enterprises, which is what, my organization cares about. It actually comes primarily from the small and medium businesses, from the individual entrepreneurs that are out there, that are usually not taken into account because of the way we look at the world today. But that's going to transform, you know, in a very large way. In fact, it was a very eye-opening thing for us when we started working with Deshpande Foundation some time ago, where we saw the way the entrepreneurs that had actually at the grassroots level figured out what are the issues, the problems, societal problems and other issues that needed to be solved, and they were completely impassioned by this, and then to hand them this technology to enable to build those solutions for that made a whole lot of sense. So we spend a fair amount of time in our in our startup program primarily to help them, not to hand them technology up front, because that's something that we feel is a given. You can always use the technology in various different ways and get the things that what you really need to do. But most of the times, because of the fact that we spend so much time talking about technology, most of us here are trained in technology or use technology so much, we usually try and put technology first, and that kind of really makes us go in a very opposite direction to what's really happening here. So you have a solution and you're looking for a problem, and if that's the way most of the entrepreneurs come to us and find that they actually are, they reach a certain level and then they fail, and then they reach the next level if you help them with a little bit of money, and then they go up to the next level and then they fail again. So Desh talked about this in the earlier session about a certain level of naturalness being there. You find the problems, you find the impassioned people who actually are willing to go after building those solutions, finding the right business models, finding the right financial models, and then implementing that through the right technology. That is where we spend most of our time. 90% of the startups fail in our mind, primarily because they go about doing things in a completely reversed way, because they have already intellectualized what they want to do and what they want to build, and they spend most of the time trying to find the right problem, and they fail. So we spend most of the time, I think, shaving off intellect, shaving off ego in our programs, and saying, hey, if you do take away all that, let's get down to what really needs to get done. And sometimes, because of the fact that in our space we worship scale, we always want to get something much, much larger. We sometimes want to not even want to worry about scale as a starting point. We want to worry more about making sure that there is a right problem solution fit. And once you do that, the ability for us to provide the right technologies, enable that, and then help grow is so much easier. So I think the way I see the workforce, if work as in the traditional way of working for large companies, which give you the instructions to do get something done, is going to change more to actually empower more and more people to actually know what problems are there to be solved, and empower them with the right methodologies and the right techniques to actually do the right things. That's where I think most of the education and the training will go into, because a very slim part of that is actually going into the technology element. So I think I would say the workforce of tomorrow, or the people of tomorrow, are going to be spending more time on the softer skills side, and only about 10% of them actually will do the deeper. So there's nothing going to be in the middle, which is the gray version of what we see as a workforce. There, that's the deepening of the thing. So whatever we're doing in AI, in ML, in big data technologies, IoT, all these things are basically about those deepening of technologies. And that's what, large corporations, large technology companies like Microsoft and Google are actually betting on. So that's where we will find that we will be building the skill sets among the workforce. So So coming back to what Jayesh spoke, I think, you know, in addition to the fact that we are doing all the things that we're doing in India, we also, you know, feel extremely proud of the fact that the government and the other organizations such as iSpirit actually have taken the time to actually build a technology infrastructure which is called the India Stack, which is, you know, creating a very data rich, very infrastructure, a technology infrastructure. So some of the things that we need to solve in terms of building those solutions no longer needs to be done from the grounds up. If there is already an platform upon which you can now start building your solutions, you are much faster. So you have the ability to throw your solutions into the market, get your feedback, and iteratively solve this much faster and get into, you know, the deployment mode much faster than you would have. Because most of the concerns of the startups are not about building some of these infrastructures, and some of them don't have the capability of doing that. So how about if we just give a level playing field to everybody and give them that level of data, that level of technology, and then let them go off and solve the problem. I think we have a unique opportunity in India to actually leapfrog a lot of the other countries being able to do that because of this kind of a technology infrastructure.
Thanks, Ravi. So if you heard Ravi very closely, he's saying something that, you know, I'll paraphrase him, we used to say inside Google, which is start with the users and all else will follow. That a day, and I used to say that a day spent with the users where they live, immersed in their life, is better than 1 year of market research. And that has helped me instead many, many times. So talking of uniqueness, so you have a unique culture where you have a lot of young people being trained to build and innovate. And then you have this India Stack, which is going to make us data rich, creating this platform for innovation. And the other thing that makes India unique, which I think I want you to address, Naveen, is that India is probably the most entrepreneurial country on the planet. On a per 1,000 basis, we have about 18 small businesses. To me, India is not just 1.3 billion people, it's also a country of 80 million small enterprises. And it gives me goosebumps to think, in the technology era, when these 80 million startups or these small enterprises reach 7 billion consumers, I think it will be a planetary scale event. And the person making it happen is Naveen, because many of these small business ideas are not going to come from urban upper middle class. They're going to come from areas like the Sandbox. So Naveen, you have started where exactly what Ravi is trying to actually causing people to unlearn, which is starting with the basics, starting with the people. Now you're moving upwards, connecting your Sandbox to MITs of the world and so on. What are your learnings and how would you, what would you advise the rest of the country to do?
If you have asked me in 2007, I wouldn't have even dreamt it. And when first I saw his slides, I said, no, it's not applicable to us. You may be talking to the 2 billion people, but I work with other 5 billion people. And then we further went into discussion, etc., etc. But the beauty of the Sandbox is that this level of discussion is happening in Hubli. The beauty of this, that like you can say that it may be Davos of development sector, the discussion that Rich is going to have. So how we can bring these layers and connect, and now the Sandbox kind of place is really a ramp where you define the $2 of excellence or $2 of capability of consuming technology or a person who has a different buying capability, how you build a ramp. And Sandbox, basically that was an experiment, and now after 10 years, we ourselves feel that now we are ready to combine all those things. Where Microsoft feel too comfortable in the last 3 years to come and see that they are engaged worthy. And one thing, comment on Jayesh, that now India has reached to the level where every 6 months someone wants to build the largest, biggest. And that's the very beautiful phase we are. And we really would like to see that everyone, next 6 months, someone else come with a. I was in IIT Chennai, they are building a 1 million square feet of research park, incubation. So like aspiration has gone up. What does it mean that they're all pushing us towards this reality what you have presented us? And how we can prepare our capability at different layers, that's more important. And very rarely privileged to have all sort of, like I have been working with Jayesh for the last 2 years, and it's kind of amazing to see that. And Jayesh, by the way, the Nizamabad TIHA will be bigger than Hubli. So we want to change all this bigger every month. And we are very thankful to working with him. He's an amazing, extraordinary person inside the bureaucracy, which kind of respond the thing in a different manner. That has totally changed my perception. Similarly, technology, and we have been working with MIT. It's very interesting to see that MIT is coming here and figuring out how we can do the chemical-less soil testing. And right now the soil testing is basically the chemical, and is more the qualitative, means low, high, medium, etc. But we never get the numbers. And now the combining these worlds, I think, of course, as Rob said, the technology is going to change. Either when I saw first your slide, I got scared. It looked like it's going to destroy all the discussion. But that's going to happen. That's a reality, whether we face or we close our eyes. But how we get this best minds and prepare ourselves to use that technology to make a better quality of life. What does mean that a lot of people thinking digital platform for the currency, but I'm thinking digital platform to supply sanitary pad. I'm thinking safe drinking water through this platform. I'm thinking how the best use of toilets, drinking water, etc. can be supplied through that technology. And that's where I see that this all thought process, etc. can help us to really see these slides in a different manner for the other 5 billion people. And we would like to see more and more Sandbox can play the facilitative role for those 5 billion. So that's how I see your slides.
Thank you, Naveen. I'll hand it to Rob, and then after that I will request each of you to comment on this particular. So if you actually look at the whole picture, if you just take one area of development, let's say healthcare, India has approximately one doctor every 1,000 to 2,000 people. And maybe not all of them are very well trained. You would not trust your life with many of them. If you take the US healthcare system, there's one doctor for every 100 people. Just the cost of providing healthcare in India to that level of quality, or even close to that quality, will cost us approximately $2 trillion. Right? India's GDP will not be sufficient just to provide healthcare of that quality. So, not only do you need disruption, but you need the right minds, right, of the kind that you are inculcating. And some of those minds need to actually come from the bottom of the pyramid for the same reason that Mr. Jain articulated. If you really truly understand your users, you'll actually build solutions at scale. Now, Rob, you've been all around the world, including Africa and so on, watching this process unfold. Your thoughts on how we're going to get there?
Yeah, it just occurs to me listening to the conversation. I'm a physicist, I have a tendency to think of things on time frames. Most of my stuff is on femtosecond time frames, but I think there are some important ones here. And one of them, one of the most important, I think, is this generational time frame. People who are currently poor smallholder farmers, for example, are going to remain poor smallholder farmers very likely for the remainder of their career, and we can't look away from that. But we can use technology during that generation or two generations during which they're in that role to dramatically improve their life. Not only in the way you were suggesting, perhaps using soil diagnostics, novel soil diagnostics, or other means of improving your yields, but also by providing services, health services, for example, education, using IT, technology that's available today. So that's another time frame. Things that are here right now that can be deployed. It seems to me that that's one of the focuses of the Sandbox, and one of the things that we are most closely focused on. That's dealing with the younger generation of innovators and entrepreneurs who can be the purveyors of these technologies now. In the long term, of course, we're trying to help educate people and develop things that can be transformative generations from now. And I have the great privilege of running at the MIT. At MIT, something called the Tata Center for Technology and Design, which is sponsored with a very large gift from the Tata Trusts, but has participation from many other entities as well, including some of the world's largest energy companies. we're looking at things that might enable doctors to be completely removed from the system, for example, within a generation. MicroRNA analyses, for example, that could be performed in clinics or even kiosks that could be used to diagnose any condition, any disease, and even issue a prescription or some other form of guidance to ill patients. So I'm very excited about the future, but I keep coming back in my mind to this nearer time frame of the need to do things now with the things that we currently understand.
So I agree with what Naveen mentioned, that while the future is exciting, I would assess that the future is still filled with lots of uncertainty. And what is exactly, precisely going to work in the Indian context may not be the same exactly as what has done well in the West. We have eventually to find our own local solutions. And in the earlier session, many speakers mentioned about the responsibility of the government to achieve scale. But I would feel that much more basic responsibility of the government is to ensure that we get our basics right. We have the basic connectivity, we have enabling ecosystems, we have been able to create a trustworthy system wherein partnerships come easily. In fact, if you look at some of the most thriving innovation ecosystems of the world, they have showcased the best partnerships amongst academic institutions, amongst civil society organizations, amongst large corporations. And in our state in Telangana, we are trying to emulate the same path. Some of the best academic institutions of Hyderabad support T-Hub. In fact, if you take the count today, we have 28 large corporations who have created accelerator programs in T-Hub. The government itself, as I mentioned earlier, has created an enabling policy through which all the startups, they get right kind of incentives. They get an opportunity to develop their first consumer, the first market. We also have a very interesting new program that we have launched, which is called T-Bridge. The idea is that if you have a smart idea which can do well beyond Indian geographies, then there has to be a conduit to take you there. And this is what T-Bridge is doing. So we are always trying to get the basics installed in the first place. And then talk about scale, of course, which is very much required given the numbers that we are dealing with. And while I feel optimistic, I still feel that we have to tread the path very carefully. One wrong step or any missing piece in that jigsaw will just kind of leave us stagnating and we'll miss the bus, so to say.
Yeah, we talked about the workforce and how they are going to be prepared for the future. I feel, you know, in terms of education, the models that we have traditionally followed for the last several years, several centuries maybe, a very, traditional structured model that was primarily to give an education to make a living, is something that's, is slowly going to change to a large extent. Not necessarily one to make a living is the most important thing, because there's so much change that's happening within the environment and the ability for you to not just seek out what you want to learn and seek out the people that you want to learn with is going to become a very important thing, you know, the way it's going to happen. We are seeing bits and pieces of that in different places. There are some telecom providers that are looking to disrupt the way education is going to be. It may not be called education as we traditionally know it, but it's what they need in terms of information, in terms of the understanding to actually do the jobs that they need to do. And that, I think, will, radically change the way people are going to approach their skilling, their level of education to go about doing this. I think that's going to be a radical change that we technologically can make happen, and India can leverage that in a big way.
Thank you. I think we're almost out of time, so I'll just close by thanking everybody on the panel. I think we can go on, and this was meant to be the beginning of a dialogue. I'm sure some of this dialogue will continue. I just want to summarize saying that I think some of the things I learned, starting with the fact that technology is bringing disruption towards us, and to address that, what India is starting to do is we are starting to empower and incubate and encourage entrepreneurship and innovation, which is a constant from the bottom of the pyramid all the way to the top. And agility is required, transparency is required, we need to move more digital. And one of the key things that Jayesh said is collaboration. We all need to collaborate. So you cannot be in silos when you're, you know, surfing the wave of disruption. And I will leave it with, you know, one insight, which I think Jayesh and both Naveen mentioned, but I think I want to emphasize it. If you take India as a country of 1.3 billion people, and you take the 300 million people out who are in some way or form in the formal economy, that leaves a billion people who constitute less than 3% of India's disposable income, right? And for them, the government of India is the only buyer. The only buyer. And we have not only have no choice, but we have a responsibility as innovators and development workers and the thinkers to work with the government, empower it, and collaborate to make sure that we reach those billion people, because all we are doing is to make sure that the brightest among that billion come up and then create the next India. And they will, if we just give them a little bit of a chance. With that.